have presented to us a number of different orders that ordinances regarding parking rates. We passed a certain amount of them. We had to delay our vote because of amendments. So I think it's a good point at this point to go through where we stand, what's been passed, what hasn't, and what we need to look forward to as far as legislation, and then be able to get any questions answered regarding what these do in terms of both implementation and revenue. And I know there was the one ordinance regarding the extension of parking meters on 9th Street that was provided, but it's at the process of being introduced and will be voted on in another 2 weeks. So I didn't know who would want to take the lead from the administration on this. I guess I'm looking for
Marcia. Marcia, can you hear me? This is Nathan Matz from the Parking Authority.
Okay, Nathan, thank you.
Yeah. Hey, I'm here to answer any questions that anybody has.
Nathan, could you just give us a real quick snapshot? And I don't know whether you're looking at like what we have already passed and then what still needs to be addressed legislatively. And then the final item is the actual agreement.
Yep, I can do that. So the first one that was not passed was 416, which is increasing the violation rate. So if you look under Exhibit A on the actual tonight's agenda, not the committee of the whole, but the real agenda, is the spreadsheet that has that all broken out. And basically, it is the middle tier pricing, except for the public safety ones, which were increased to the $100. And then it has the penalties, which go up 50% after 10 days. And then it goes up another 50% after 30 days. So that's the big piece of 416. Does anybody have any questions about 416?
I'm looking through it if I see any questions.
Marcia, am I in?
Yeah, yes, you are, Strat. I just wanted to ask for, and I don't know whether a point of order or a point of business, that it's really important when you're not talking to put yourself on mute because we are having echo. I'm hoping everyone can do that. And it's just the courtesy that we normally do with Zoom meetings. Because I still hear, okay, thank you very much. Okay, does anyone have any questions about what Nathan presented? I don't see anyone.
The other ordinance is the loading zone ordinance. That was tabled as well.
Okay. Which one?
That's Bill 101, 2020. That's amending Section 576, 411.
411, okay. So 411 was amending to include the 98 loading zones.
Correct.
As metered zones for the downtown business core. Any questions about that?
Donna has her hand up.
Yeah, Donna.
We amended that, correct, Marcia? We amended that for a 60-day trial period.
No, that amendment did not pass.
I apologize.
We had so many amendments
last week. Trying to remember. Okay, so okay. No problem. Thank you.
And then I asked, I had entered a motion for it to be tabled because I wanted to see where everyone was at when the amendment didn't pass.
I see Johanny has her hand up. I don't know if you can see that motion.
Yeah, I can see. Yeah, Johanny, unfortunately, I don't see your, okay, so you're down in there. Okay, Johanny, thank you.
Okay, hi, can everyone hear me?
Yeah, very good. This, yeah.
Oh, good. Linda, I took Ken's advice, so thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, so I have a few questions. I'll go one by one, okay? So the first one is related to the vehicle registration and inspection sticker. Is that an exclusive role and responsibility of RPD?
Johanny, I'll answer your question. And the answer is no. It's something that is a dual responsibility according to city ordinance. And this is a question it's been raised a lot by the public. So we have a big front page on our website, a written response from our lawyer in dealing with that, because there's a section where you can cite under the state statute, which that is only the RPD, the police department, is allowed to cite under that statute. We are not. So where our enforcement officers cite is based on the city ordinance for the city violation. So there is kind of that duality, and sometimes people get confused about who can do what. Police can write both. They can write city ordinance and state statute. Our guys can only write city ordinance.
Does that help you, Johanny?
Yes, I just wanted clarity on that because I think that was in a work group that I attended. I remember that question being asked, and there wasn't a lot of clarity. So if your solicitor said it's okay for RPA to collect, then I guess it's okay, right?
Yeah, and I sent out an email to all the city council today with that opinion on it. So if you didn't get it, let me know.
And I will check. Thank you, Nathan. And then and so I have two more questions. So section 576-414, non-payment of parking fee, as well as 576-509, parked overtime at a meter space. How is that different from section 576-402? Where it lists 10 minutes, 15 minutes, and so on.
Okay, give me one second, because those are very
specific. Take your time. Yes.
And they're not the ones that we were proposing change to. So okay, and what were those numbers one more time?
Sure. At the very top you have 576-402, which lists the minutes.
Yep.
And then further in the bottom of the spreadsheet, you have 576-414 and 576-509.
So 402, so 402 is the ordinance that specifically talks about limiting time. So there's all different delineations of time that are enumerated here. So 10 minutes, 15 minutes, 1 hour, and those are just signs. Those are not actual meters. So those are those are timed restrictions based on a sign, not time restrictions based on a meter. So that's 402. So 509 is the actual meter. So if you're parked and you didn't put money in at a meter, it's 509. But then 504 is parked overtime at a limited meter zone. So there's four zones set up under the meters. There's 30 minute zones, hour zones, 2 hour zones. So it's if 504 is if you put money in, but it ran out and you stayed past the 1 hour limit. So they're very specific, but there's slight nuance differences between them. So did I explain that?
Yes, thank you for the clarity. Yes, and also related.
It's confusing to look at just mm-hmm. as a spreadsheet.
And then as it relates to the meter that have time, why is it that you have some areas that have 30 minutes, some that have an hour, and some that have 2 hours? What's the explanation behind that?
To be completely honest, I don't know why they were set up that way in terms of who and which block was put on a 30 minute, which one was put on an hour, which one was put on a 2 hour. The idea behind it, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. The idea behind it is in areas where you need high turnover really quickly, you put it in the lower in that 30 minute maximum and you get people to move over really quickly. I don't know the rationale behind why everything was established the way it was. I was not a part of that. So I don't know.
So is that something that we can fix, modify? Like, can we analyze where they're 30 minutes, hour, and 2 hours? And I've been speaking to a lot of constituents who are not happy about the Saturday parking meter. And, you know, and then in addition to the parking meter, then they're limited to the time. So some meters are an hour, some are 2 hours. So I'd like to get some consistency with like the time frame, if possible, because I think that for, especially for the commercial areas where you take some hair salons on North 9th Street, and even some on North 5th, I think on North 5th, there's 30 minutes, whereas on North 9th, I think it's an hour or maybe even two. So they like, if they're going to be expected to pay Saturday meters, and also there'll be an increase in the fare, they like to get more more timing if possible.
I mean, I
would love for us to like explore that and consider that.
Sure. I mean, I personally, you know, from our side, as long as they're paying, I don't care if they park there all day, if they can afford it. But what it comes down to is, you know, business owners, I don't, that would be my only concern is if we lift that restriction of a time, as long as they're paying, you know, that then it comes down to the owner of the business and is there still going to be enough turnover? So that's kind of,
I understand, I guess I'm trying to also understand like the nature of the business. So let's take a hair salon where the average time might be 2 to 3 hours, for example.
Sure.
So, and I understand that obviously there are these applications that from their phone, they can add more money. But with some of the constituents that I've also spoken to, there's also some limitations to the apps, and I'll list them. So one, obviously, not everyone being familiarized with how the app works, or maybe feeling limited or intimidated by the app. And the second thing is that the app also charges a fee for usage, whereas I would think that we would want to discount people for using the app so we can encourage more people to download the app, if that makes sense.
Can I make a suggestion here? Because I think we're getting into a lot of very important details that I'm not sure for tonight's meeting, but it looks like something we need to look forward to is maybe that we set up a work group just as we had to look at the original ordinances and be able to look at all the issues and concerns of what's working and what's not, which is what I originally was proposing but was defeated last meeting as far as looking at the loading zones. But maybe we need to do it looking at what we have moving forward. Because I agree with you, Johanny. We need to be able to understand why things are tiered a certain way, how those things change with the application of the app, how that works and doesn't work for certain constituencies. So it's a lot of detailed types of things that we already have moved ahead, but we certainly can revisit. Would that be agreeable to you, Johanny?
Yes, I think, yes. And I understand that there's a parking study that's going to be conducted in the near future as well. Am I correct?
And so some of that might tie in together. Lucine had her hand up, so I just wanted to be able to give her an opportunity. Thank you.
Well, you know, I had my hand up because based on what Johanny was asking is a question that has come to me as well, which is, you know, let's say I'm parked in a metered spot, you know, for X amount of hours, it says 30 minutes, but I just keep feeding it. What will happen, right? If I keep paying the meter, what will happen? But that can be answered at an appropriate time. I think my question to fellow counselors is, it's really important to decide how we're going to discuss this because some of us have taken individual time to connect and to ask these questions. Now work groups are being proposed. You know, this was presented to us by the Parking Authority for review. I'm feeling that the administration, you know, has reviewed and is in support of what's being presented. So I feel like some of this is going out of order and it's confusing to me. You know, when something is on the agenda and when it's ready for review, you know, what can we expect? Is it typical then to, you know, continue to table and break it down for work group sessions or, you know, how should we proceed to get the information and clarity that we need?
And I want to lend some clarity to the process is that when we originally just started this discussion, it was regarding the agreement with the Parking Authority and what they needed as far as looking at revenue. So I almost feel like we've started these ordinances, which haven't been looked at. And to Johanny's point about having a parking study, it's not addressing the whole complexity of all the parking issues that are in Reading, which I think needs to come in another time and place. How we do that, I think, needs to be decided. And Don, I saw your hand was up. Because you served on the Parking Authority too, so you have some other insight into this.
And I remember when we did a Parking Authority study, parking study, and that would have been circa 2008, 2009. So there's probably vestiges of that still around, and I'm not sure what if that's being looked at it or it ought to be looked at, I suppose. But to the question, and I understand where Lucine's coming from, I understand where Johanny's coming from. I think this, just what we're hearing from our constituents, just exacerbates their concerns and their puzzlement over all the different parking situations. You know, we can assume that everyone understands the apps, everyone knows what's going on, but I think that's not necessarily true. Even if you have a cell phone, maybe you don't do the apps or whatever. You know, I think the Saturday parking probably threw a lot of people. I understand the reasoning behind it. I just think the more we ask these questions and the more we get them in some kind of extremely clear, transparent way to explain to the public, the better it's going to be. And I've been asked questions. I'm sure all of us as council members have been asked questions, but we have to be as open in public meetings as possible discussing these because the work sessions are great for us, but it doesn't help the public.
And Donna, just to clarify, when I talked about the work group, that would be a public meeting, okay? It wouldn't be something that the public
would. There have been discussions within small groups, which occurs right. prior to this.
Right.
And that's fine. That's protocol, that's committee, that's all that sort of thing. But parking is as much of an issue for the city as anything is, as public safety is, because people don't understand parking. They don't feel comfortable. They don't know when they feel like they're going to be, you know, blindsided by a ticket. It has implications for economic development, especially now as we hope to come out of COVID in the next few months and we can have more normal commerce down the road. This is a time to get it all straightened out. So when things revert to some degree of normalcy, our service businesses, our eateries, their constituents, their clients can feel comfortable and feel that they are they're being treated fairly.
Councilor Goodman, if I could, please.
Victor Mark, thank you.
Thank you. I just wanted to provide just a couple contextual details on a part of the conversation that's going on. The comprehensive parking study RFP is due tomorrow. If you were to go to the bottom of the city's website on the right side and click bids and contracts, there is a detailed map showing all of the areas under consideration for the parking study. When the council body and the administration of the previous administration had initially looked at the parking study, there was an attempt to do it citywide, and the cost of that was ginormous, which is not a technical term, but it was very large. So the study was curtailed to these specific areas that are detailed on the map in the front of the RFP that's available on the website. And that's due tomorrow. On the parking app issue, Mr. Mads, please correct me if I'm wrong. If the zone does not authorize extended parking, then the rate would automatically double to what the car had paid when they signed up for the 2 hours. If they were to continue in that space beyond what's initially authorized, is that correct?
I cannot speak to that. I'll have to look that up and get back to you.
And I think what I'm hearing, and counselors, correct me if I'm wrong, is that we have a lot of unanswered questions or more discussions that needed, but we have some major ordinances, some which we passed on Monday, but we still need to consider tonight. Now, I guess I want to get a sense from the body, how comfortable are you moving ahead with what's on the agenda? Not that I want in any way to procrastinate it, but I also want to make sure everyone is able to look at the whole picture as they're voting on these and don't get caught off guard by their constituents for not being able to thoroughly answer what the implications are.
Councilwoman Marsha, if I could quick interject one thing, if that's okay. So and you spoke about this earlier, the ordinances that we presented tonight is a very, very slim piece of the total package that we originally proposed, because we have started the process of going through all parking ordinances to revamp and update. So as you spoke about earlier, we only presented these six because they're the most important to get through budgeting and finances. So what our plan is moving forward is to continue to present in small pieces like this, six or eight at a time, the rest of the ordinances that we've been working on to bring everything up to date. So if you wanted to do that and continue in a work group for the other ordinances, we would be more than willing to do that. I mean, it's time intensive, but we're more than willing to do that for all the other ordinances that we will be proposing in chunks over the next couple of months.
Any thoughts on Nathan's proposal, how we move forward? Because this is more process.
If I may, process is really where I'm coming from as well. Having just gone through that with another authority, I think it's really important to define what the process is and the timeline, so that we all know what we're working towards and what we're trying to accomplish. So, you know, if I'm not opposed to what Nathan presented, at the same time, you know, with the ordinances that have already been passed or are being considered, you know, once they're on for business, they're on for business. And I wanna make sure that we're doing our job in that piece of it as well. So I'm not opposed to having whatever type of work group or discussion moving forward as these come in blocks. And however, whoever wants to be assigned to that or however we're gonna do that is fine. And the time, you know, kind of the time lapse here in accordance with the parking studies, I think is really important.
Okay, so for our business tonight, we have one ordinance that's parking related for final passage. And that has to do with the loading zones and the addition of parking meter fees to loading zones located in the parking zones. And I think for the purpose of tonight's meeting, we should focus on what we have on the table as an agenda item, and then be looking at what the process is, because there also are a number of them that are gonna be introduced tonight. Does that sound workable for everyone?
So I just want to make sure everyone's okay with these ordinances. I have not had the time that you guys have to spend on them. They're never going to be perfect. There are things, if we need to adapt to them later on, we can. You know, things can always be changed. So, but I do want to make sure everyone's got at least their bigger questions answered so that they're comfortable. I think you're kind of guiding it that way, Marsha, anyway. So,
Yeah, well, I just want to focus on the one we have on the agenda for tonight to make sure that we're focused just on the loading zone, not that all these other issues aren't important. And then we need to come up with a timeline on how we get them answered. And to Nathan's point, how he introduces new ones. Lucine?
To answer your question, Marcia, ordinances for final passage, I see 576-411, but I have to say, you know, even trying to lead us through the meeting with, you know, ordinances that were being introduced, that were being discussed, the amendments that were occurring, was very confusing. And I'm wondering, I feel as if though there are some that are not on for final passage and or new ordinances that we've already been discussing. So I'm getting really confused in the process. You know, for example, I think that we've talked about, you know, we've talked about some of them. One of them, 517, you know, it was, are tickets going to be placed on the cars or can they be mailed? You know, I remember talking about these. So I'm at a point now where I am getting confused as to what ordinances have we talked about, what have been put on, you know, for final passage, what have been tabled at this point. It's seeming to be very disorganized and I don't like that. And so I don't want things to be falling through the cracks. So I feel that there's at least two or three that we've talked about and I'm just not seeing them. And I don't know when or where they're coming. So
well, that's a good point, Lucine. So if somebody could recap what was already voted on and then what's voted on tonight and then what remains, that would be helpful.
Okay, and Nathan, if you would speak to what was voted on, or I could go back on I'm just trying to think, pulling up the minutes from the last meeting. I was just trying to focus on what was going to be voted on tonight.
I have the meeting minutes in front of me.
Okay, Linda, could you read what we passed at our last meeting last week?
Yes, the first one was Bill 98, 2020, which amends the City Code Section 564-105 by increasing the penalty fees for the improper storage of trucks, trailers, and mobile homes. The next one was Bill 99, and that amends Section 576-503 that allows parking meter enforcement on Saturdays. The next one was Bill 100, and that's amending 576-419 regarding the issuance of daily parking permits, and that's the manner by which they're placed out in the community. Then we go to...
Now, those all weren't passed, though.
Yes, those were passed.
Okay.
And then the loading zone and the large amendment to the parking fines, those two were tabled.
Okay.
So on tonight's agenda, the loading zones, that's Bill 101, 2020, under final passage.
Right.
And Bill 102, 2020 is under introduction of new ordinances. Mm-hmm. That needs to be reintroduced due to the increase in those fines.
Okay. Does that help everyone get on where we're at? And you can find that in the agenda and the minutes from last Monday's meeting.
It does, Marcia, but and then what lies beyond those? Just the one that's being introduced tonight, or are there others that will be coming as well? Or is that
there were others that are being introduced tonight?
For example, what Johanny had been questioning earlier, the amendments to 576-402, that's not been proposed to us yet.
And I think, Lucine, and then Nathan.
Well, and that's where I'm getting confused. So in addition to what Johanny was asking, 517 is what I asked about. 603, I feel like we had talked about that. That was the reduction of the number of violations and the payment plan. Where is that one? And then I know we talked about the different rates being charged for no parking, you know, for nonprofits and, you know, that one, I'm trying to find...
Let's take a break here. So, Lucine, you're mentioning a couple specific ordinances. As she steps through those, Linda or Marcia, can you tell her where we are? They've been approved, they're on the table, or they're forthcoming. So, I want to make sure everyone's clear.
Can I just make a comment too, Jeff? Because one of the things that did happen with this process is they all haven't been moved forward through the city clerk's office to even be put on.
And that's okay. And then I think we just give it that status.
Okay. Linda, could you walk through those?
The ordinances we're introducing tonight are the, again, Bill 102, which amends 576-416, increasing and reducing parking fines and penalties. And that was amended at the meeting last Monday. Then we have the amendment to section 212-144, which is the reduction in the booting fee and modifying the daily parking permit fees and the parking meter fee, raising the parking meter fee. Then we have amending 576-502. That's the parking zones, where they're adding certain areas of the city to add parking meters to. Then we have 576-413 regarding the authority of the police chief to void parking tickets, and section 514 requiring the police department and parking authority to provide notification regarding temporary changes to parking regulations and rules. And that's it.
Okay, and to be able to say that there were certain ones we didn't discuss last Monday, which included the parking zones, because that one Linda hadn't received in time for us to discuss at last Monday's meeting. So that one hasn't even been touched on yet. And I'm just looking here. We also,
Marcia. Yeah, that's on this evening.
Yeah, that's on this evening for introduction. Nathan?
And there's two that we introduced or we sent over to be on the agenda for tonight that Lucene is referencing, 517 and 603. We sent them on Wednesday last week, but I just don't see them on it tonight. There's a lot on the agenda tonight, but I don't see 517 or 603.
Okay, and you did send that over by Wednesday of last week.
Yeah.
And I don't remember.
Okay, so one of the things that I'm hearing, and I would really, whoever might be, work with the city clerk, I think we need to have these all done in a table form to be able to say, this is where we're at with all of the different parking-related ordinances. This is the status of whether we pass, so that we have a concrete list to be able to look at, so we can all reference that back. And then Nathan, to the point that I know you're talking about things coming up in the future, we need to have some order to that as far as when they're not, rather than then this slowly being added. I think people like to look at the bigger picture when they're making decisions, because it's all intertwined. And so I'd like to be able to, you know, work with council to be able to see what the process looks like. But at least for the ones that are being introduced or have been voted on, that we can have a sense of what those look like. Would that help with what you were asking, Lucene? Oh, yeah. Okay. Bring this up. Anyone else have any questions? I just want to look at what we're going to be voting on tonight. Marcia,
regarding the ordinances that we're covering, that we're voting on tonight.
It's only one.
Are we okay with that?
Yeah. That was going to be my next question. So again, let me read the ordinance for tonight for final passage. Amending City Code Section 576-411 via the use of loading zones and the addition of a parking meter fee to use loading zones located in the parking zones established in the City Code Section 576-502. We did have some discussion about this last Monday, but I don't know that we reached a consensus where we were with this one. Nathan, do you want to make any comments on this ordinance?
Yeah, I mean, we just introduced it because, you know, we're losing potentially $500,000 a year through these 98 loading zones that are in metered areas. So I've answered most of the questions that have come up. I wasn't sure if there are any other questions about it?
Donna?
You know, I've had real concerns about this. I think like Jahani, a lot of us have. I think we should move forward on it, but I do think we reserve there's the possibility that if it seems unworkable, if it seems, you know, to be something that simply cannot be tolerated and it starts to impact our business community in a negative way, we need to have feedback from everyone so we know you know, a month or a couple months down the road what its impact is.
Okay. And just to clarify for council, and I understood why this might be amendment that had been put out on the table was to do exactly that, to do an evaluation process to see the feasibility, how it would work. That, unfortunately, from my point of view, was not passed, so therefore we don't have that as an amendment. So if we move forward with this, unless it's amended again tonight at the table and voted on again, we may, depending on whether it passes or not, we may end up going into something where we don't have any evaluation metrics included in the ordinance.
Or the feedback will be anecdotal, which then we have to consider the strength of anecdotal feedback.
Yeah. Thank you. Any other comments? And again, I think you understand the parking authority's rationale. I know that it does create issues for businesses whenever you add additional fees. So again, you need to weigh both of those. We're looking at additional revenue.
And council, I am absolutely more than willing to do like a 4 month or a 6 month update, you know, once it's rolled out. Absolutely. And it will not be rolled out immediately. This is something where if it passes, we're gonna have to pay the software developers to get this implemented and work through it. It's something we haven't invested a ton of time into and money as of now, because we didn't want to do that if council wasn't on board with it. So if I was realistic, this probably wouldn't really start until probably April at the earliest. And then we could always do a 4 or 6 month update to council after it starts to see where we're at.
Johanny has her hand up.
Okay, sorry, Johanny.
It's okay.
Yeah.
I'm not very comfortable with this, and because I understand also that the parking authority would have to make an investment too on the meter purchases. And I feel like we should probably hold off on this altogether because already we're making other changes, you know, like the addition of the Saturday parking meter. And it's like, I wouldn't want to like overwhelm the community or like with all these increases in fees or additional fees all at once, if that makes sense. Mm-hmm. And I'd like time to explore what I mentioned prior in terms of those time constraints without a specific rationale that I know obviously we'll be looking into, and also maybe even consider the parking study that's coming. So that's kind of where I stand with that. I'm not comfortable with it.
Okay, thank you. Lucene?
So I am open for a fellow counselor to propose amendment again as to an evaluation process. I would support that very much. And I believe that with respect to what Johanny was saying, I disagree. I think this is one of them where this is specifically geared to generate revenue from those outside of the community. So those larger corporations that are, you know, statewide and nationwide that have the ability and have already, you know, negotiations in many other cities to pay a fee for use of a loading area. I don't feel that this one is as of a direct impact to constituents and to residents and to shoppers coming in. And I think we need to be mindful of that because we're in a deficit, you know, we're operating with a deficit. We have to pay attention to the areas in which we can with least impact, try to generate revenue to support our city and operating. So, you know, for me, I would feel comfortable moving ahead with this one tonight. And I would be very open to the proposal of an amendment if it's so moved.
Okay. Any other comments? Melissa, Strat? Okay. Jeff, have any other comments on this?
No, I think I'm about as good as I'm going to get. Honestly, I've been relying on you guys on these ordinances. I appreciate all the work that everyone's done. A lot of good questions from everybody. So good stuff. The only one I have, the ordinance regarding the meters in the 400 block of North Street, that's been amended already, correct?
Correct.
All right. That's the only question I have. Otherwise, I'm good to go.
Okay. So as far as passage for tonight, we have covered that ordinance. Again, going back to what I had asked as far as having a spreadsheet with all the ordinances and when their status, which ones are due for our future passage. So we make sure that we have enough time to discuss those. And then the other request from the parking authority is to give us a sense moving forward what is going to be looked at so we can get all of them all timelined out. So it's a matter of, it's almost going to mean, seem to me, over a year, we're going to be having parking ordinances being considered at most meetings. Am I correct, Nathan?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, and if you guys want to set up a work group again for that, or if you just want us to present them, you know, in blocks, we can do either way.
Okay. Lucine?
Yeah, I just want to take a minute because I think we're actually on the precipice of something really good. You know, look, we've talked about our authorities and how we've just had difficulty in holding them accountable and communicating with them and getting reporting from them. So I think as we move forward with the parking authority to consistently throughout the entire year have an open dialogue in, you know, presentation of different ordinances and areas for consideration is the right way to do it. And so I applaud all of us for having this conversation and consideration instead of, you know, ignoring. And then a couple of years down the road, you know, we identify there's a big problem. We haven't been talking with each other. And where do we even start? So I'm really pleased with the direction we're taking on this.
Yeah. And for myself, I like to see everything with performance measures and metrics so we can look at what the metrics are for each of these ordinances and then have a report back so we understand what we're actually seeing. Now there's another, not an ordinance, but we have a resolution on the table for tonight for authorizing the execution of the amendment to the Parking Authority Memorandum of Understanding. And we needed to table that at our last meeting because we were showing a difference in revenue amount. So I don't know whether administration or Nathan want to walk us through that.
Yeah, so we updated the amount and we sent that back over in line with what we discussed, which was the tier two pricing, which would be an annual contribution worth $1,761,000.
Okay, any questions on that resolution?
Okay. Marsha Johani has her hand.
Yeah, Johani, I got you. That thing that's
thank you.
Time.
Okay. So I had my hand up because I you know, I see Lucine's point. I'm sorry, I want to go back to the loading. I apologize. I just want clarity on what the amendment was because I remember us having a conversation about either reduced or no cost to our local businesses that offer delivery and would need the loading zones versus a fee for those that are coming from outside the city. So I just wanted clarity on what that amendment would read.
And Lucine?
Yeah, I just want to speak to that. So I was the one who had proposed a consideration. I think it needed to be reviewed by legal as to whether or not that could be done to offer some kind of discount for, you know, businesses inside of Reading versus outside. And I think, and please correct me if I'm wrong, the amendment form really came in trying to create a evaluation period and reporting. And then at that time is when we could have that legal review and advice given to us or an opinion based on whether or not we could do those discounts or considerations. So that was not part of the amendment. The amendment was solely to set up a period of review post activization. And please, you know, correct me if I'm incorrect on that. That was my understanding.
You are correct as far as the amendment had to do with the evaluation. There was no formal amendment put forward to look at the different types of fees, local businesses versus non. And so I agree with what Lucene's saying. Is that something the solicitor would need to give input on if that was an amendment that was offered?
So how would we then proceed regarding that
Would you like to offer that as an amendment, Johanny?
I mean, ideally, I wouldn't want there to be a fee for any Reading business for using the loading zones. Now, anyone outside, you know, Lucene made a valid point that I would consider, but I wouldn't want to penalize our Reading business.
Right.
Yeah, so I mean, it could be, I'm sorry.
Okay, go on, Nathan, and then.
So it would be kind of set up like the no parking signs are now, where no parking has, you know, a discounted rate for a city resident. It's just in this case, it would be a city resident's business or a registered business within the city. I mean, we have those multiple tiered pricings already in a different section of the ordinances, which would be the no parking signs. So I don't see why it would be an issue to do that from our side in dealing with the loading zones.
And I also would also be curious to see if we have any data regarding the use of the loading zone and who is it mostly utilized by. Would it, you know, what's the percentage of outside business versus local business? I don't even know if we have the ability to capture that data, but I'm hoping that, as you know, one of our goals is to be more data driven so it can help us make better decisions.
Yeah, that would be a really good piece of data, and it would also be incredibly hard to capture without having people out there on the ground, because we don't have any we don't have them using the app currently, so we don't have any way of gathering that currently.
Lucene?
Yeah, Nathan, that's exactly where I'm going with this. So if we move this forward and then we have people using the app and registering and paying during the loading zone process, then we will be able to gather that information. And I think that if, you know, someone wants to make an amendment at this time for the consideration of the solicitors to review, you know, whether or not it's discriminatory to offer some type of tiered or discounted rate for those, you know, in Reading that have a business privilege license as opposed to businesses outside of Reading. I'm happy with that. I'm also happy just getting through this first hurdle of activating this and then, you know, taking that into consideration once we start gathering those metrics.
Okay, and I'm going to be asking a question of the solicitor. I think when you make an amendment, it's how you want to change the context of the ordinance and not to have the opinion really needs to come before you would make the amendment. So, Anna, in what we're saying here, do you feel that's something that you would need to research to say whether it was a discriminatory issue to have to fee rates for city and non-city businesses?
Well, I would say that it would be ideal for us to research that. If I were a business that didn't qualify for the reduced parking, you know, I might challenge that, especially if I'm doing business in the city. So I think it should be looked at. As a practical matter, though, we could do. If the idea is to try to do a trial period and just see how an across the board loading zone fee would work, and then we could study its impact on city-owned businesses, that's certainly something that could be done immediately if that's the approach. If the approach is that we would like to have two or more parking rates from the beginning, I would like some time to look at that. I think it's potentially problematic, although there's a reason for it. And I think as a city, we are allowed to show some preferential treatment to our businesses and our residents. So I'm not saying it's going to be problematic, but I'd like to look at it.
Okay, because I see that there are still loose ends to this ordinance, I would rather have it tabled at this point so we can get some of that clarity from our solicitor about the two-tiered system, and then come back and be able to decide how we actually want to move forward.
Are you referring to the one ordinance on the table tonight?
Yeah, and Jeff, it's only because I feel like there's things that have been introduced that we're not ready to have answered in order to be able to take a vote. There were questions that didn't come up before.
What meaning the one you just raised regarding business owner versus non-business owner,
right,
paying for a loading zone? What's the loading zone going to cost? Anybody know? I don't have it in front of me.
It's the hourly rate. It's $2 an hour.
Okay. How much an hour?
No, that's $2. No, now it's $2. They're proposing an increase to $2.80.
Okay. Yeah, you know, you can always come back and amend this thing. I like the concept of, you know, taking a view of what's there. I think we're starting to over-engineer this a little bit.
Okay.
And I would rely on Nate and his team to tell us what will work for them. And, you know, I certainly think, you know, city business owners should inevitably not pay anything, but let's get it there first. And maybe we should just make them zero out of the gate. I don't know. I don't know how you implement all that. We're getting into some really big weeds here. And I think we need Nate and the administration to kind of guide us a little bit, because a lot of what is, you know?
Okay. Lucene, and then I'm going to take one more set of questions, and then we really need to move on.
No, not a question. I'm ready to move forward on this. I'm happy if there's an amendment that wants to be put forth of an evaluation period. I think everything else we've addressed is subsequent to activating this ordinance, and that's my viewpoint on it.
Okay, thank you. Any other comments? Okay, because we need to move back to the resolution regarding the amendment. I'm just looking in the chat room. I don't see anything. Okay, so amending the MOU, and I think Nathan spoke to that. It was just increasing the amount that would come in from the parking authority from what had been previously introduced. So anyone have any questions?
Shohani here.
Yeah.
So the cooperative services agreement includes the ordinance fee changes, correct?
No, that's the agreement with the city. It's all of the, when you say what fee changes are you speaking of, Johanna?
I'm sorry. So is the cooperative services agreement just with the set price? Or are we attaching the ordinance fee increases to reflect that amount? Do they go together or are they just completely separate?
Let Nate answer that, please.
So the agreement is strictly dealing with, you know, issues between the city and the parking authority, but specifically what it's talking about is the contribution of the $1.7 million from the authority to the city. The ordinances are not attached to that, other than there's a clause in there that says we need these ordinances that are increasing our fees to get us to be able to contribute that $1.7 million.
Thank you, Nathan, for the clarity. Appreciate it.
Okay. Okay. Anyone else with any questions about the resolution for the MOU? I'm looking. I don't see any hands up. I don't see anything in the chat room. Okay. Then we're ready to vote on what we've discussed at tonight's meeting.
Okay, Marcia, thank you. We're going to move on to agenda review. This evening we have Cesar and Rode Herrera from the St. Christian Fellowship Church. Is that correct?
Yes.
And then we have no proclamations. Anybody signed up for public comment, Linda?
I have one written submission.
Okay. Is it? Okay. That's fine. And you'll read that for us?
Yes.
All right. Well, then we have the approval of our agenda and minutes, include the minutes from December 28th and the and January 4th committee of the whole meetings, as well as our regular meeting under the consent agenda legislation. I guess A is just a blank, right?
Correct.
That's nothing.
Right.
All right. So the first item is a resolution disposing of the 2014 statement of financial interests and gift forms. That's pretty standard, right? 7 years has gone by. Any comments or questions on that, anybody? All right, the next item on the consent agenda is a resolution authorizing the promotion of paramedic firefighter Michael, let me get right up. I need better glasses. Is it?
Sninsky,
yeah, to Deputy Chief EMS effective January 16th. Any comments or questions on that? All right, we have a resolution authorizing the continuation of the collection of solid waste from the Reading School District facilities for one additional year. Anybody have any comments or questions on that resolution?
I just have a question. I'm just curious. And I don't know if I got a response because I didn't check my email, so I apologize in advance for that. Do we have the intergovernmental services agreement? Just because I think it was it created in 2013, if I'm not mistaken? I was just curious where the document is. I would just like to read it.
Yes, Councilwoman, this is Abe Amoros. There was a document that was sent to you earlier today.
It came from Bea Rivera.
Okay, thank you.
All right, any other comments or questions on that item, on that resolution? All right, the next resolution is authorizing.
Yeah. Oh, I'm so sorry. I just saw through the chat that Kevin Lugo couldn't speak. I don't know if he needed to speak on that. I don't know that there was a question, but I don't know if people are checking the chats or not. So I open that to the administration if there was a comment that the administration needed to make on that.
Okay. I don't see any at this point, right? I mean, okay. All right, we're going to move on then to the final resolution on the consent agenda is authorizing the hiring of the following individuals, officers for the Reading Police Department. Edgar Rios, Rene Rios, Aaron Levin, Michael Cintron, Michael Kaiser, and Jeffrey Yuri. Any comments or questions? I'm sorry, Ann McKenzie, I'm assuming is that Adams or Adame?
Adame, I would say.
Okay. Any comments or questions on these hirings? All right. We'll have the administrative report with both the mayor and Abe will be on this evening.
Yes, sir. I will be handling the administrative report. Thank you.
All right. And then we're going to go to Maria. We do have a brief, very brief presentation from Aaron on the downtown public-private partnership. Is that still on, Linda?
Yes, sir.
All right, and then we'll move on to ordinances for final passage. The first bill is going to be 101-2020, amending the city code section 576-411 regarding the use of loading zones and the addition of parking meters and meter fee to use loading zones located in the parking zones established in the city code section 576-502. We've just spent the last hour on that. I think we've addressed most of the questions for that. The next item is authorizing the extension of the DID for a 5-year period with the final plan and authorizing the execution of the services agreement between DID and the city. Any comments or questions on that? All right, the next item is bill number 2-2021, amending the city code section 212 regarding the building trades and property maintenance fees initiated at the December 28th regular meeting. Is there any comments or questions on this issue? All right, Marcia, did you want to walk us through these introductions, if you don't mind?
No problem, Jeffrey.
We're going to take time to see if there's any questions on each of these, just preliminary anyway.
Yeah, and one of the just words of caution as we move forward, a lot of these are parking related, so I think we're going to need to have, as we discussed earlier, more time to go over these. So Bill 102, amending City Code Section 576, 416, increasing and reducing parking fees and penalties as attached. Amending the City of Reading Code Section 212, 144, vehicles and traffic to reduce the booting fee and modify the daily parking permit fees and parking meter fees. C, amending the City of Reading Code Section 576, 502, parking zones, establish traffic control maps as attached. D, amending City Code 576, Section 413, and regarding the authority of the police chief to void parking tickets, and Section 514, regarding the police department and parking authority to provide notification regarding temporary changes to parking rules and regulations. Okay. Any preliminary questions on those? Oh, I see Johanny. I saw your hand this time.
Thank you. When will we be discussing it during the next committee of the whole?
I believe there's some time put aside next week to cover any questions, yes, Johanny. And I would do what I think you did this time to address any questions ahead of time as well. That'd be great.
Yeah.
And just an FYI, Chief Stout, put a question or a comment in Q&A. He would like a moment of silence for the firefighter call.
Yeah, thank you. And I was going to ask that too. Very good point. Yeah.
Chief, will you be willing to make a few comments? We'll do that obviously at the beginning of the meeting.
Of course. Thank you all.
Okay.
One last thing. I'm so sorry. Linda, Representative Manny Guzman sent a late email requesting to speak at the meeting.
Well, our cutoff time is 4:30 for 4 o'clock. I'm sorry.
Is he on the call?
No.
Yeah.
Any objections, body, to allow Manny 3 to 5 minutes to speak?
No, not at all.
All right, we'll give him the time. That's not a problem. Okay.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Then we're moving on with the introduction of ordinances. Ordinance C, amending City Code Chapter 62, pensions by replacing administrative oversight references to finance department and by allowing the mayor to designate a representative to replace him on the fire and O&E pension boards. Who can speak to that from the administration? Abe?
Councilor Goodman-Hennerschutz, just a slight correction. It's not to replace the mayor, but it's to be able to vote as a proxy in his place at the pension board meeting.
Do you think that needs to be reworded then to make that accurately reflect what you want to see happen?
Yes, ma'am. If that would be council's decision, that would be preferable to the administration.
And I guess the other question I have is I would really like just the solicitor to weigh in on that too. And then you don't need to do that tonight, but I think it's important before we vote on that.
Okay. Very good. And our office was asked to review that a while ago, so we can speak to that at the next meeting.
Okay. Okay, Ordinance F, amending the property maintenance rules and regulations in the city's code of ordinances, chapter 180, part 12 is attached in exhibit A regarding solid waste. Okay, Abe? Or is there someone from your departments that can speak to this?
Can everybody hear me?
Yeah.
Kevin's on.
Okay, this is Kevin. So the ordinance change is not very large in terms of content, but there were a couple of changes we needed to make to the QOL ordinances. For example, in the location where it talks about whether or not trash cans can be out front, it specifically only says trash cans. It does not say recycling containers. So there were a couple changes we needed to make in the ordinance to better allow us to do enforcement Clean City Goals. We also updated some other things that brought the definitions into alignment with the definitions in the new solid waste code. So that's kind of a housekeeping item. And then there were two new quality of life ordinances added at the end. It's QOL 24, which is temporary dumpster maintenance. So in the solid waste code, we do require temporary dumpsters to be covered when they're not in use. If you think like the big roll-off containers for construction projects, this would add a simple way to enforce that. And then QOL 25 is for improper use of litter receptacles. Basically, litter receptacles are meant for small items. You know, household trash is not supposed to be in them. You're not supposed to put your tires next to them or your electronics next to them. That would have a small QOL that we would use for enforcement of that. So it's not a holistic change of these. It's just tweaking these QOLs to better meet our enforcement goals.
Okay, any questions? Looking over in the chat room, I didn't see anything. I do have a question, Kevin.
Okay.
Okay, with a discussion that happened when we were originally passing the ordinance regarding picking up from seniors in the rear, is that in any way reflected in the ordinance?
No, this enforcement is a QOL ticket. So it's not changing any of the ordinance that was passed in the previous ordinance 49-2020. This is just specifically quality of life ticketing.
Okay, thank you. Okay, Johanny, I caught you that time.
Thank you, Marcia. And this may be maybe on topic or off. You let me know if we have to wait to discuss. But so I had a constituent ask me about the Clean City program fee. Is there such a thing, or is that something that we are working on discussing and so on?
Excuse me. That is the fee, the portion of the fee in your RAWA bill for trash and recycling that goes to our Clean City programs, our litter abatement, illegal dumping abatement, and so forth. That fee has always existed, but it is just, it shows up differently on the bill now because of the ordinance from last year.
So is it a fee applicable to everyone, or is it a fee exclusively for people who are keeping private haulers? I just wanted some clarity.
The question comes from how the bill is actually shown. Anybody who is on either trash or recycling, so anybody who's on both would also be included, is paying that fee. But if you are on, if you're grandfathered into a private hauler, then you're only paying the Clean City fee, you're not paying the trash fee. So you'd be paying Clean City and recycling. Someone who's on both services pays trash, Clean City, and recycling.
And what is that fee, Kevin, please? If you have that information.
Sorry, you mean how much?
Yeah, how much, yep.
Let's see, it's $15.5. It's $2.50 per unit per month.
Got it. And then one last question, I apologize to the group, but another question a constituent had was, if they have a property that's vacant, are they subjected to pay for trash and recycling, although the property is vacant and doesn't produce trash or recycling?
So all properties have to have active trash service that has not changed. So if they're still on a private hauler contract, then they can stay with that. If they're not, they're added to the city's program. And yes, they would have to pay. It is tied to the number of units. So if it's a vacant lot or a property that's being demolished, there'd be no units, there'd be no fee. If the water is actually turned off, they have no water access, that would be a reason to have the fee taken away. But otherwise, if it's a unit that's just currently not occupied, they would have to pay the fee. And that's a decision that was made a long time ago before I was around. But I believe part of the idea is that we don't want to give people breaks because they're leaving housing empty.
If I can interject, there's actually, this was decided by the Commonwealth Court in another case and a case involving Reading. And the thought process is that it involves the fact that everybody's getting the benefit of the recycling and waste programs. So it's something that's been decided and the courts have upheld it.
Thanks, Fred.
Okay, any questions? Any more? Okay. Johanny, do you still have your hand? Okay, thank you.
Councilor Goodman-Henderschitz?
Yes, Jamar.
Sorry, I had an update regarding Ordinance E. I finally found it in the packet. On page 74 of the packet, the heading actually specifies it's requesting the mayor to appoint a designee. But on the agenda, it's misworded to say replace him. So if we just strike that from the agenda, we should be fine.
Okay, thank
you. But the actual ordinance says designee.
Okay, thank you for the clarification, Jamar.
Thank you.
Okay, I'm just making sure. Okay, so we're at ordinance, wait a minute. G, amending the solid waste ordinance 496 part two regarding collection from mixed use properties.
So this one is actually dealing with the ordinance as was passed last year. In the ordinance that was passed, the language required all residential properties to be on the city service if those properties had six or fewer units. And over the last about 6 months now that that's been passed, I've been doing a lot of work talking with residents, talking with property owners. And what came up was that there are a handful of properties in the city where you have a commercial unit on the ground floor and say, you know, three units above that are residential. It's a mixed use property. Many businesses operate with their own trash service because they have their own special needs. But some of these businesses are operated, their trash service is operated by the landlord. So what ended up happening was with the ordinance as it was passed last year, the business would be required to have a separate trash collector because businesses are not supposed to be on the city's program. But the residential units above this, the business would be required by the ordinance to be on the city's collection system. So you had a situation where for a handful of properties, you're actually required to have two different services, which would be duplicative. So looking at that, this amendment proposes to solve the problem by allowing people, owners of mixed use properties, to opt in to the city's collection service for those residential units, but not requiring them to use the city service. And so we have some properties that actually already are using the city service. They had been prior to the last ordinance. And we have some properties who I've spoken to several owners where they say, you know, our business needs to have a dumpster and we put our residential trash in there as well. Can we just keep the dumpster instead of having two services? And so they would then not be required to be on the city service.
Any questions? Whoops. I don't see any. Okay. Then the last ordinance is H, increasing the salary of the community development director to $110,000 contingent on the $20,000 contribution from the Reading Redevelopment Authority retroactive to November 23rd, 2020. Who would like to speak to that? I wanted to have the administration and then Lucien, I'll recognize you.
Yes, Councillor, thank you very much. We're hoping that this gets immediate action. This has been in the works for quite some time. In fact, it even predates me from November the 9th. So we're hoping for quick council action as soon as possible. And it also relates to the other employees that are going to be affected in community development. Again, this is an issue that has been in the works for quite some time and we're looking forward to bring it to conclusion. Thank you.
And the understanding is it's introduced so it can only be voted on another 2 weeks.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you. Lucien?
Yes, just a reminder to the administration, I've asked for an organizational chart and for a review of the integration of the Redevelopment Authority into the Department of Community Development. I would like to see something that speaks to that request that I've made prior to having this on the table.
Will do. Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
Marcia, just a point of clarification. I believe that, and this can be addressed by the time it's voted on, I believe that it is supposed to be retroactive only until January 1st. Abe, I think that was discussed. It may not be reflected in the, may not have made it to the agenda, but that was my understanding for various reasons that it would only be retroactive to that date. I can clarify that between now. Is that your understanding as well?
That is my understanding. And to his credit, Mr. Abadallo has agreed to that. And he wants to make sure that the other two employees have their retroactive date to November the 23rd. So we will gladly go along with that as long as the other condition is met. Thank you.
Okay, just for purposes of putting it on the agenda then for 2 weeks, we should amend it to be January 1st, the retroactivity yes. date to be January 1st.
That's what it says now.
Okay, I'm sorry, on the agenda, the one that I have it, I might be looking at an old version. So I apologize. If it says January 1st, then that is correct.
And speaking of agendas, I'm just wondering if the website has been updated yet. I was looking for information and I was unable to find it.
Yeah, I'm reading the agenda from the website and it says November.
Yeah, and that's where I pulled it down from. I apologize, but I usually go right to the website when I'm pulling down my agendas.
Well, it sounds like everyone's in agreement, though, that that was the intent. And then certainly for purposes of when it's voted on, it can be it can be January 1st.
Right. And if I could just return to a comment made by Councillor Salnick, if you could check to see if you have received the organizational chart. I've been told by the Director of Community Development that that was sent. So if you could just double check that. And if you haven't, we'll be happy to resend. Thank you.
Okay, so that's it for ordinance for introduction, Council President.
All right, thank you, Marcia. We'll move on to resolutions. We have just two of them this evening. The first one is 181-2020, authorizing the execution of the amendment to the Parking Authority Cooperation Memo of Understanding. That's been discussed pretty thoroughly. And then the second one is the resolution regarding the appointing Mary Kelleher to the Board of Health. Any comments or questions on the second resolution? No? All right, well, that's our agenda for this evening. Before we leave this meeting, is there any other issues that needed to be discussed in public this evening? Outside of our regular business meeting, any topics anybody needs to get to?
Just a reminder that we have a HARB hearing tomorrow at 5.
At 5, okay. All right, it is 6:23. Let's plan on starting at 6:35 and being in the room at 6:30.
Jeff, Donna had a question.
Yes, Donna, go ahead.
I had asked about a possible executive session. I think I caught, you were copied on that, Jeff, 2-8.
Okay, let's do it now. Is it an executive session? No, hold on, let me just pull it up.
I mean, the question is, I think it falls under executive. I'm a little.
Yeah, let me look at it. I'm sorry.
It may not.
Yeah, I don't believe it is.
Yeah, because we'd have to deal with personnel or litigation.
Donna, and I don't believe we're prepared to go through it tonight.
I think we have to go through it soon.
Right. But I don't want to put Abe and everybody on the spot here. Unless you're prepared for that.
Council President, I am prepared to discuss it, but to your point, if you wish to take more time, that way I can provide council members with a comparative analysis on the issue that Councillor Reed is referring to. And what I'd like to do is just take a look at surrounding municipalities in reference to the question that was asked. And I think that you'll find it very useful.
Yeah, I think that's important to have sufficient time to prepare, and that way we're able to present it in a way you want to present it. So, Don, are you okay with that?
I'm okay with it. I just, the sooner the better, because I think this is an issue that we're all being, that has raised concerns across the board.
Agreed.
Okay. Any other issues that we need to discuss? Let's meet and start our meeting at 6:35. I would try to be there at 6:30 in the other Zoom queue. Right. Unless Linda blocks you.
So should I plan about 30 minutes for the executive session next Monday?
No, there's no executive session. That'll be a public discussion.
Okay. Can someone send me the topic, please?
We will then.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you. See you in 10 minutes, 5 minutes. Thank you.